press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
Hi everyone. In our earlier videos, we discussed respiration process that occurs in five different steps, and you learned how breathing occurs and how the exchange of gases takes place and how the blood will transport oxygen and carbon dioxide. So everything you learned in the earlier videos. So in this session, I would like to discuss the regulation of respiration, how the respiration process is controlled or regulated. And what is the normal rate of breathing in a healthy human adult? It is 12 to 16 times per minute. So the normal rate of breathing is 12 to 16 times per minute. And humans have the ability to regulate the rate of breathing according to the need of the body. See, for example, during normal conditions, we breathe 12 to 16 times per minute. But when you are doing vigorous exercise or during a strenuous exercise, what happens? The body requires more energy. And to produce more energy, the body cells require more oxygen. To cope up with this, the rate and the depth of breathing increases. So this, the rate and the depth of breathing increases. And similarly, see, whenever there is an increase in the concentration of carbon dioxide or hydrogen ions in the blood, what happens? The rate at that time also, the rate of breathing increases to expel more carbon dioxide so that their level will comes to normal. Okay, so the human beings have the ability to regulate the rate of breathing according to the need of the body. And the respiration process is controlled in two ways. One is nervous control. One is the nervous control, and the other one is chemical control. Okay, let us see how the nervous system will regulate the process of respiration. Nervous system consists of various respiratory centers. So what is respiratory center? A respiratory center is nothing but a group of specialized neurons. It's a group of specialized neurons. There are two respiratory centers are present. One is respiratory rhythm center, respiratory rhythm center, and pneumotaxic center. Okay, so the respiratory centers are nothing but what? A group of specialized neurons or the nerves which are located in the brain. So there are two types of respiratory centers are seen mainly: the respiratory rhythm center and the pneumotaxic center. Okay, so this respiratory rhythm center is located, let us discuss in detail. Respiratory rhythm So this respiratory rhythm center is located in the medulla oblongata. Which is a part of hindbrain. So where this respiratory rhythm center is located, it is located in the medulla oblongata of the hindbrain. So this respiratory rhythm center, it is mainly controls the basic rhythm of respiration. So it controls the normal rhythm of respiration. So it causes either inspiration or expiration according to the neurons get activated. So according to the neurons gets activated, the respiratory rhythm center causes either inspiration or expiration. So by doing so, it controls the rhythm of normal rhythm of respiration. So there are two groups of neurons are present in the medulla oblongata. Okay, there are two groups of neurons are present in this medulla oblongata region. So the respiratory rhythm center is also called as medullary rhythmicity area. Okay, so in this area there are two groups of neurons are present. One is dorsal respiratory neurons. Dorsal respiratory neurons and ventral respiratory neurons. Dorsal respiratory neurons and the ventral respiratory neurons. So this dorsal respiratory neurons and ventral respiratory neurons are also called respiratory centers. So according to, they're nothing but what? Just a group of neurons which are located in the medulla oblongata region of the hindbrain. So they're also called as what? The respiratory centers. According to the function they perform, they are called as dorsal respiratory neurons are called dorsal respiratory neurons. It's called as inspiratory center, and ventral respiratory neuron is called as expiratory center. So both are located in the medulla oblongata of the hindbrain. So that is called medullary rhythmicity area. So the inspiratory center. So the nerve signals from these neurons, they stimulate the inspiratory muscles. So they stimulate the inspiratory muscles to carry out the normal rhythm of respiration. So this inspiratory, the neurons of this inspiratory center, no? The neurons of this center, they remain, they're active for 2 seconds. The neurons of inspiratory center are active for 2 seconds and the rest for 3 seconds. So the average time taken by, so average time taken to complete a respiratory cycle is 5 seconds. So in that, inspiration lasts for 2 seconds, whereas expiration lasts for 3 seconds. Okay, so the time taken by the completion of a respiratory cycle is 5 seconds, out of which inspiration, the time taken by inspiration is 2 seconds and the expiration will last for 3 seconds. And these neurons of the inspiratory center, so the neurons which are present in the inspiratory center, no, they are active for 2 seconds and they will take rest for 3 seconds. Okay, so when they are active, listen carefully, when they are active, they send a signals. So they send a signals to the inspiratory muscles. So what are the inspiratory muscles? Which are the muscles involved in the process of inspiration? So external intercostal muscles and the muscles of diaphragm. And the muscles of diaphragm muscles. So these are the muscles involved in the process of inspiration. So when the neurons of inspiratory centers are active, they send a signals to the inspiratory muscles, that is external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm muscles. So upon which these muscles will contract. So when these muscles contract, what happens? The volume of the thoracic cavity. So when the muscles contract, the volume of the thoracic cavity increases and the pressure inside the lung decreases, so that the atmospheric air will enter into the lungs. So that is what inspiration. Understood? And at the end of 2 seconds, so the neurons of inspiratory centers, they becomes inactive. So at the end of 2 seconds, the neurons becomes inactive and the external intercostal, so the signals from the center ceases, stops, so that the external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm muscles will relax for 3 seconds. So in the relax, what happens when they relax? The size of the thoracic cavity decreases, volume of the thoracic cavity decreases, the pressure inside the lung increases, and what happens? The air which is present inside the lung is expelled out. So that is what expiration. So this inspiratory center, that is nothing but a dorsal respiratory neurons which are present in the medulla oblongata region of the hindbrain, maintains the normal rhythm of respiration. Understood clearly? Now, ventral respiratory neurons. So they are called as expiratory. This is called as expiratory center. So here, this expiratory, the neurons of this expiratory center, no, they remain inactive during normal respiration. So during normal respiration, this center remains, expiratory center, that remains inactive. But when they are active only during a vigorous exercise. So when you are doing vigorous exercises, the neurons of the expiratory center becomes active. Okay, so when they becomes active, they send signals to the muscles. Which muscles? They send signals to internal intercostal muscles and abdominal muscles. So upon which what happens? So internal intercostal muscles and abdominal muscles contract. So when they contract, the volume of the thoracic cavity decreases. So the pressure inside the lung increases. Okay, so when the volume of the thoracic cavity decreases, the pressure inside the lung increases, so the air which is present inside the lungs is forcibly expelled out. So this causes what? Forcible expiration. Okay, so the neurons of the expiratory center are responsible for forcible expiration, and they become active only during the vigorous exercises. But during normal respiration, they remain inactive. And the inspiratory center, it controls the normal rhythm of respiration. Understood clearly? So these are the respiratory rhythmic. So these two, that is inspiratory center and the expiratory center, are both are located in the medulla oblongata. Understood? Okay. So that all together, the both these centers together called as medullary rhythmicity area. They're located in the medulla region of the hindbrain. Okay. So inspiratory center maintains the normal rhythm of respiration, and expiratory center, so this center, the neurons of the center will active during vigorous exercises and responsible for forcible expiration. Okay, so this is how the now this respiratory rhythm center is mainly, it is primarily responsible for maintenance of the normal rhythm of respiration. Okay, now one more center, which is the one more center? Pneumothoracic center. So there are two types of respiratory centers are present in the respiratory rhythm center. So this center, it causes inspiration or expiration according to the neurons gets activated. Okay, according to the neurons get activated. So the center is responsible for inspiration or expiration. So thereby it maintains the basic rhythm of respiration. Understood? And one more center is what? न्यूमोटैक्सिक सेंटर, न्यूमोटैक्सिक सेंटर, न्यूमोटैक्सिक सेंटर इज लोकेटेड इन पॉन्स रीजन ऑफ हाइंड्रे. Pneumotaxic center is located in the pons region of hindbrain. So this is responsible for, this center is responsible for reducing the duration of inspiration. See, this pneumotaxic center moderate the functioning of the respiratory rhythm center. So respiratory rhythm center, it maintains the normal rhythm of respiration, no? So the pneumotaxic center will moderate the functioning of respiratory rhythm center. So the neural signals from this center reduces the duration of inspiration. So the neural signal from this center reduces the duration of inspiration. So thereby it alters the rate of respiration. Okay. So pneumotaxic center, where it is located? It is located in the pons region of hindbrain. Okay. So what is the function? So it is responsible for shortening of the duration of inhalation or inspiration. Okay. So thereby, when the duration of the inspiration is reduced, the rate of respiration alters. No. So this is responsible for, this center is responsible for reducing the duration of inspiration. So it moderates the, so thereby it alters the rate of respiration. So it moderates the functioning of respiratory rhythm center. Okay. So this is how the respiration process is controlled by the nervous system. Okay. So the respiration process is regulated by the respiratory centers, which are located in the brain. Okay. So there are two types of respiratory centers. As I said, respiratory centers are nothing but what? A group of nerves or neurons. Okay. So the respiratory rhythm center located in the medulla oblongata. So in the two groups of neurons are there, that inspiratory center and expiratory center. So that inspiratory center is responsible for maintaining the normal rhythm of, that maintains the normal rhythm of respiration. And expiratory center, it is responsible for forcible expiration. So both are located in the medulla region of the hindbrain, and pneumotoxic center will located in the pons region of the hindbrain, and it moderates the functioning of respiratory rhythm center. Okay. So this is how the respiration process is regulated by the nervous system. Okay. And one more thing, another is by chemical control. Chemical control is brought about by chemoreceptors, which are sensitive to chemicals. Chemical regulation is brought about by chemoreceptors which are sensitive to chemicals. So there are two types of chemoreceptors are present: central chemoreceptors and peripheral chemoreceptors. Central chemoreceptors and peripheral chemoreceptors. So central chemoreceptors. So the central chemoreceptors, so they are located on the surface of medulla oblongata of the hindbrain. So they are located near the respiratory rhythm center. So these chemoreceptors know, so the central chemoreceptors, they are highly sensitive to carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions. So these chemoreceptors are highly sensitive to carbon dioxide and as well as hydrogen ions. See, for example, whenever the carbon dioxide concentration and the hydrogen ion concentration increases in the blood and the body fluid, so these chemoreceptors get activated. Okay, so whenever there is an increased concentration of carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the blood and the body fluid, so these central chemoreceptors, no, they get activated and send a signal to the respiratory rhythm center. Okay, so upon which the respiratory rhythm center get activated and it increases the rate and the depth of breathing. Okay, so this allows the expelling of more carbon dioxide which is present in the blood and the body fluid. Okay, so that their levels will comes to normal. Okay, so chemoreceptors are sensitive to the levels of carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions. So whenever there is an increase or decrease in the level of carbon dioxide and hydrogen ion concentration, so these chemoreceptors, they get activated and send the signals to the respiratory rhythm center to alter the rate of breathing. Okay, so when the carbon dioxide concentration increases, the rate and the depth of breathing increases. Whenever the carbon dioxide concentration decreases, what happens? So the rate and the depth of breathing, the rate of breathing decreases. Okay, so the chemoreceptors, there has their highly sensitive to carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions. Okay, so they maintain the level of carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the blood. And what about peripheral chemoreceptors? Peripheral chemoreceptors. So what are these peripheral chemoreceptors? So the peripheral chemoreceptors are present in carotid body and aortic body. So they are located in the carotid body and the aortic body. So where are these aortic and carotid bodies are located? Aortic body is located in the arc of the aorta. So it is located in the arc of the aorta. So you know aorta, what is the artery arising from the heart which supply oxygenated blood to all the parts of the body, you know. So that is what the aorta. This is what ascending aorta and this is descending aorta. This is ascending aorta. Here comes the arc of the aorta. So here is the presence of aortic body. Okay, so the aortic body are located on the arc of the aorta. And what about carotid bodies? So the carotid bodies are located on the carotid arteries. They are located on the carotid arteries. So there are two carotid arteries, right and the left carotid arteries, which supply blood to the neck and as well as the brain. Okay, so these two are the carotid arteries. So this carotid body is located on both the carotid arteries, where the carotid the two carotid arteries will bifurcate into internal carotid artery and the external carotid artery. Okay, so they are located here. So the carotid body are located here. So this is our aortic body and these are the carotid body. So both these contains what? The peripheral chemoreceptors. So these peripheral chemoreceptors are also sensitive to the hydrogen carbon dioxide and as well as the hydrogen ions. So like that of central chemoreceptors, peripheral chemoreceptors are also sensitive to what? Carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions. Okay. And these peripheral chemoreceptors are also sensitive to the low level of oxygen concentration in the blood. So they are also sensitive for the low concentration of oxygen in the blood. See, when the blood is flowing through the arteries, so these peripheral chemoreceptors, they recognize the level of carbon dioxide, okay, and hydrogen ion, and as well as the oxygen. So when the blood is flowing through the arteries, these peripheral chemoreceptors, which are located in the carotid body and the aortic body, they recognize the level of this carbon dioxide, hydrogen ion, and the oxygen concentration in the blood, and they send signal to the respiratory rhythmic center. Okay, so they send the signal whenever there is a changes in the level of either carbon dioxide, hydrogen ions, and oxygen concentration in the blood. So they detect those changes, okay, and they recognizes the changes and send a signal to the respiratory rhythmic center to make a necessary that adjustments, okay, so to increase the rate or to decrease the rate of breathing so that their level will come to normal in the blood. Okay, so this is about the chemoreceptors. So chemoreceptors are nothing but what? How the respiration process is controlled. So the chemical control is by the chemoreceptors. So what are chemoreceptors? So these chemoreceptors are they are sensitive to chemicals which are present in different parts of our body. So there are two different types of chemoreceptors: central chemoreceptors and peripheral chemoreceptors. So central chemoreceptors are located on the surface of medulla oblongata. Okay, that is near the respiratory rhythm center. And these chemoreceptors, now they are highly sensitive to the carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the blood. So whenever there concentration of carbon dioxide and hydrogen increases in the blood, so these chemoreceptors get activated and send a signal to the respiratory rhythm center, and upon which the respiratory rhythm center get activated and increases the rate and the depth of breathing, so that their level will comes to the rate of and the breadth of breathing increases, so that the more carbon dioxide is expelled out and their level will comes to the normal. Okay, and peripheral receptors, chemoreceptors, where the peripheral chemoreceptors are present, peripheral chemoreceptors are also present, they are present in the carotid body and the aortic body. So the carotid body are located on the carotid arteries, where they bifurcate into external carotid artery and the internal carotid artery. So here are the carotid bodies, and aortic body, they are located on the arc of the aorta. Okay, so both these contains what? The peripheral chemoreceptors, and these chemoreceptors are also sensitive to the level of carbon dioxide and hydrogen ion concentration in the blood, and they are also sensitive to the low level of oxygen in the blood. Okay, so they are able to recognize the changes in the level of carbon dioxide, hydrogen, and oxygen. So accordingly, so these peripheral chemoreceptors will send a signal to the respiratory rhythm center to make a necessary adjustment. Okay, so that is how the level of carbon dioxide, hydrogen ions, and oxygen concentrations are maintained in the blood. Okay, so this is how the respiration process is controlled. One is by nervous control, and another one is by chemical control. Understood? So now the last thing is disorders of respiratory system. Disorders of respiratory system. So there are so many disorders are there related to respiratory system, but in our NCERT they have mentioned only three disorders of respiratory system. See, the first thing is asthma. So it is one of the common respiratory disorder. It is one of the common respiratory disorder. It is caused mainly due to, it is the cause for asthma. So the asthma, no, it is caused mainly because of the allergens. Okay, it is caused mainly due to the allergic reaction to certain foreign substances which cause allergy. Okay, so it is mainly caused due to the inhalation of allergens. Allergens means what? The agents which causes allergy are called as allergens. So these allergens may be pollen grains, or maybe house dust or molds. So anything which causes allergy. Okay. So asthma, it is mainly because of allergic reaction to the allergens, that is to the foreign substances. Okay. So that is the cause. And let us see the symptoms. Symptoms. That is spasm of smooth muscles. Spasm of smooth muscles which are found lining the wall of bronchiole. Which are found lining the wall of bronchiole. So spasm means what? It is the sudden involuntary contraction. So spasm is nothing but a sudden involuntary contraction of the smooth muscles which are found lining the wall of the bronchiole. So it is due to the spasm of smooth muscles, the lumen size get reduced. The lumen becomes narrow. Okay. So the spasm results in the narrowing of the air passages. And there is an excessive secretion of mucus that clog the airways. And one more thing is the swelling of the lining of air passages. Swelling of the lining of air passages. So the spasm of the smooth muscles which are found lining the wall of the bronchiole, excessive secretion of mucus, and also the swelling of the lining of air passages. So all these symptoms results in difficulty in breathing. So it is due to the spasm, the lumen size get reduced, no, and the mucus secretion, so it clogged the respiratory airways. Okay, the air passages gets clogged, and the swelling of lining of air passages also reduces the lumen size. So all these symptoms causes difficulty in breathing and coughing, and also wheezing means what? Production of sound during coughing, that is what wheezing. And also the feeling of tightness in the chest. Okay, so all these are the symptoms of asthma. Okay, so all these are the symptoms of asthma. Spasm of smooth muscles of the bronchiole, excessive secretion of mucus, swelling of lining of air passages, difficulty in breathing, coughing, wheezing, a feeling of tightness in the chest. So all are the symptoms of asthma. So asthma is mainly caused due to the inhalation of allergens. It is mainly caused due to the allergic reaction. Okay, so this is one of the common respiratory disorder. And one more example which is given in the NCERT is one more respiratory disorder is emphysema. So what is this emphysema? So this is one of a chronic respiratory disorder, so which damages the wall of the alveoli of the lungs. So the main cause for emphysema is what? Tobacco smoking. Cigarette smoking is the main reason. What are the symptoms? Let us see the symptoms. See, it is due to the excessive cigarette smoking. What happens? The wall of the alveoli get damaged. The wall of the alveoli get damaged. And also, the wall of the alveoli and as well as the bronchioles loses the elasticity. Okay? So, loss of elasticity of the wall of bronchiole and alveoli. Okay? So it is due to the loss of elasticity of the wall of bronchiole and the alveoli, the surface area that it is available for the exchange of gaseous exchange get reduced. So it is due to the loss of elasticity, the surface area for gaseous exchange is reduced. Okay, so for efficient exchange of gases to take place, the surface area must be large enough. No, so here it is due to the elasticity, as the alveoli, the wall of the alveoli and bronchiole loses the elasticity, the surface area gets reduced, so that efficient exchange of gases will not take place between the alveoli and the blood, so that the alveolus Okay, so that the air gets accumulated. So what happens? The air gets accumulated in the alveolar sac. Okay, so this condition, it is called as what? Emphysema. So that is the term emphysema means what? Full of air. That means what? The alveolar sacs remain are filled with air even after expiration. So even after expiration also, the alveolar sacs are filled with air. It is due to the reduction in the surface area. So that due to the reduction in the surface area, the exchange of gases, efficient exchange of gases will not take place, so that the air will accumulate in the alveolar sac. So that is what? The emphysema. That is not the... means what? A full of air. Okay, so this is what? Emphysema. Artha aitalva? Then understood clearly? Yes. So we discussed asthma and another one is emphysema. So what is the main cause for emphysema? Cigarette smoking. So what are the symptoms? The wall of the alveoli, it is due to excessive smoking, what happens? The wall of the alveoli get damaged, and the wall of the alveoli and bronchiole they loses the elasticity, the surface area gets reduced, so that efficient exchange of gases will not take place and there is accumulation of air in the alveolar sac. So that is what emphysema. Okay, so this is what emphysema. Then one more disorder which is given in the NCRT. One more disorder which is given in the NCRT, that is occupational respiratory disorders. Occupational respiratory disorders. So as the name itself indicates, so these disorders are related to what? Occupation. So these are related to the occupation of the individual. So the main cause for occupational respiratory disorders is because of prolonged exposure to harmful substances like fumes, gases, dust and other harmful chemicals. Prolonged exposure to harmful substances. See, the persons working in industries, like mining industry, okay, cotton industry and also the grinding and the stone breaking industries, they are continuously they exposed to dust and as well as other harmful substances. So due to the continuous exposure to these harmful substances, so that results in what? The respiratory, acute and as well as chronic respiratory disorders. Okay, so now what is the main cause for occupational respiratory disorders? It is mainly because of long-term exposure or prolonged exposure to harmful substances in the environment where the persons are working. Okay, so that is the main cause. Okay, so it is due to long-term exposure to these harmful substances. So that results in the acute and as well as the chronic respiratory disorder. So as it is related to occupation, the place of work, these disorders are called as what? Occupational respiratory disorders. The more common occupational respiratory disorders are, one is asbestosis and another one is silicosis. So these are the more common occupational respiratory disorders, asbestosis and silicosis. So asbestosis is caused mainly due to inhalation of, it is mainly due to the inhalation of what? The tiny fibers of, small fibers of asbestos. Okay? So asbestosis is mainly because of the inhalation of tiny fibers of asbestos. And silicosis. So silicosis is mainly because of prolonged exposure to silica dust. Prolonged exposure to silica dust. Okay, so that causes our disorder that is known as respiratory disorder, that is known as silicosis. Understood? So asbestosis, it is caused due to long-term exposure to the fibers of asbestos, and silicosis, it is caused mainly due to prolonged exposure to the silica dust. So these two are the common occupational respiratory disorders. And let us see the symptoms. Symptoms. Inflammation of lungs. So inflammation means what? The swelling and the redness of lungs. So that is called as what? The inflammation of lungs. Later it leads to fibrosis. Fibrosis. So fibrosis means what? Excessive formation of the fibrous tissues in the lungs. Okay? That is proliferation of fibrous tissues. So excessive formation of fibrous tissues that causes, due to fibrosis, the lungs get severely damaged. So the fibrosis causes serious damage to lungs. Because serious damage to lungs. Okay? So these are the symptoms of what? The main symptoms of occupational respiratory disorders. Fibrosis. So excessive formation of fibrous tissue that cause serious damage to the lungs that even lead to the death of the person. Okay? So as these disorders are mainly related to, so they are mainly because of prolonged exposure to harmful substances. No. So one should avoid a prolonged exposure to such harmful substances. And the workers who are working in industries, no, so they should compulsorily wear the mask so that they can avoid these respiratory disorders. Okay, so this is about the occupational respiratory disorders. Okay, so there are so many disorders are there related to the respiratory system, but only the three are given in your NCERT. So one is what? Asthma. Asthma is because of allergic reaction. And another one is, second one is what? The emphysema. Emphysema is mainly because of what? Excessive cigarette smoking. So that is, what is the symptom? The wall of the alveoli get damaged and loses the elasticity, so that surface area gets reduced. Okay, so that results in the accumulation of air in the alveolar sac. So that is what emphysema. And one more is the occupational respiratory disorders. So that is related to the occupation, so where the persons are working. The most common occupational respiratory disorders are asbestosis and the silicosis. So you have to remember, so asbestosis is because of the inhalation of asbestos, and silicosis because of the inhalation of prolonged exposure to the silica dust. Okay, so these are the symptoms. Fibrosis, okay, inflammation of lungs, fibrosis, okay, which causes serious damage to the lungs. So this is what the occupational respiratory disorders. Okay, so this completes the topic, that is breathing and exchange of gases. Okay, so just we recall, so what we discussed in this chapter, so we discussed the respiratory organs of different animals. Okay, so what is respiration, what is breathing, okay, different types of respiration, okay, and what are the respiratory organs of different group of animals, and also the process of respiration, mechanism of breathing, exchange of gases, transport of gases, and regulation of respiration, and also the disorders of respiration. Okay, understood clearly? Okay, then. Thank you.